And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor and privilege to be here today with the author of Musts, Maybes, and Nevers, a must-read book if you're in love with the movies like I am. It's the legend himself, David Picker. Hey, David.
Hello.
Okay, all right, you're not a legend.
Okay,
right.
Thanks. It's a little easier. Okay.
All right. It's
I'm just
man,
the author of the book.
The author of the book. The man behind the scenes who's had the most amazing life in the movie, starting when you were a kid.
Well, yeah, so even before that. My grandfather went bankrupt in 1912 in the textile business, and he opened a Nickelodeon in the Bronx, built into a chain of theaters, merged with
his friend.
I'm
from the Bronx. Where was it?
Well, he was born in the East Bronx, but the Nickelodeon was in Manhattan.
Okay.
But he merged with his friend Marcus Lowe, and they became part of Lowe's Theaters. He had four sons. My dad was the oldest. They all went in the movie business. So I've had a father, a grandfather, seven uncles, a sister. My sister Jean Picker Furstenberg ran the American Film Institute for 27 years, and I've made some movies. I run some movie companies. And most importantly, I go to the movies all the time.
Well, I go to the movies all the time, too. Being a critic, I'm like stealing myself away here from the New York Film. I skipped Tilda Swinton this morning to come over and talk to you. But we'll get to that later. Her movie is very good, and I'm going to forget the name of it. Oh, The Only Lovers Left Alive. Anyway, I saw that in Toronto, where Michael and I just got back from. But your childhood going to the movies, your father used to see movies
every day,
and you'd say, was, "Daddy, what movie?"
Well, that's yeah, Dad. As he rose up in Lowe's Theaters, he was the chief buyer and booker of the circuit, and the only way in those days you could judge the movies was to see them. So every day after lunch, part of his job was watching a couple of movies. And when I was old enough to go, I used to hang out every day I could on my vacations. And sit in the screening room at Lowe's Theaters at 1540 Broadway, up on the 18th floor, and watch movies.
What a life. And that was just your teenage years. And you started in the business by being an assistant to one of your uncles?
Well, no. I started in the business during my summers in college. And then I went in the Army for a couple of years. And then, of course, with the people I knew, I really could have gone into any company. But I chose, to my father's, I think, slight disappointment, not to go into exhibition, but to go into production and distribution. Mm-hmm. And my Uncle Arnold was one of the partners in United Artists, the new United Artists that Arthur Krim and Bob Benjamin had bought from Chaplin and Pickford, a defunct company then, and created a major force. And I went to work there. I was 26 years old, and a couple of years later, I became assistant to the partner in charge of what was then called advertising, publicity, and exploitation, but was in fact marketing. And he was also in charge of production, the pictures they would do. And I became his assistant. And after 2.5 years of that, he decided to leave the company. And Mr. Krim and Mr. Benjamin decided to give me his job. And I was 30 years old. And the first project that I recommended to them was this British script I'd read and had gone over to London to explore its possibilities, giving my bosses a copy. The title of the script was Tom Jones.
And, which is one of my favorite films of all time, well, I just have to say. Thank you.
And I told them that I wanted to meet the filmmaker and that I was, if I was happy, I was going to recommend it. And I called them after dinner, London time, got them in the office, said I'd met Mr. Richardson. I really believed the company should do it.
Tony Richardson.
Yeah, Tony Richardson. And they supported my enthusiasm. They had read the script. They didn't tell me that. I had given them the script before I left. It turned out that they really didn't get the script, they later admitted to me. But they didn't want to discourage me on the first project that I was enthusiastic about.
Wow.
And so they greenlit the movie. And it was, I guess, a year and a half later that Tony was away in Thailand, and I graciously accepted the Oscar for Best Picture on his behalf.
Yes, I saw that. Yeah, it was on television. That was my favorite movie. I can name all the actresses who were nominated for Best Supporting Actress who were in that. Dame Edith Evans, Diane Cilento, Joyce Redmond. Three from the same picture. I don't think that's happened before or since.
There was an interesting experience. Arnold, my uncle, was visiting London, and the picture was being edited, and wanted to meet Tony. He didn't know him. And Tony asked if he'd like to see a few minutes of cut film, which is unusual, because at UA they didn't have to do that, but he must have liked Arnold. And Arnold went to the screening room. Tony showed him a scene between Albert Finney and Joyce Redmond in bed, snacking on food. And I was in my office in New York, and my secretary says, your uncle's on the phone. Hey, Arnold, how are you? He says, well, I just saw some footage on Tom Jones that Tony showed me. I said, you're kidding, he showed you some, he must have liked you. I haven't seen a foot. And he said, yes, I've never seen a scene like it. I said, well, what do you mean? He said, I mean, I've never seen a scene like it. I said, well, what scene did you see? He said, I've never seen a scene like it. And he said, it's the most erotic thing I've ever seen. And it was that scene.
The famous eating scene from Tom Jones.
And when the head of our distribution in London, who was a very kind of stiff upper lip chap, saw the movie, he turned to Arnold and I when Tony had left the room. And he said, I will tell you in my opinion that this picture is unreleasable in the United Kingdom. And we said, Monty, what are you talking about? It is unreleasable in the United Kingdom. Monty, you know, don't worry about it. We'll take care of it. And Arnold refused to give it to the Rank organization because he didn't think they owned most of the theaters. He didn't think they'd want to take the picture. They'd be scared of it. They might do it, but they wouldn't promote it or anything. And so he bought a theater in the West End for the company and opened it in the Pavilion Theater, the theater we owned. He did that several times. He did it with Last Tango in Paris, too, when he didn't trust the exhibitor. And, of course, the picture, in the case of Tom Jones, won the Oscar.
Why did he think it wasn't releasable? It was too...
Because he was a stuffy Brit whose taste was up his rear end.
Okay.
He loved his poodle. He just didn't get movies.
Oh, God. So many people in executive positions in films these days seem to...
Well, yeah, but these days, but in those days, it was a problem.
Yeah, these days, today, I mean, the movies are just... Well, we'll get to that.
I've seen some real good movies lately. Come on.
Well, being a film critic, I can say that. I pick and choose.
Yeah, but a very famous person once said, it takes 30 years to be an artist and 30 seconds to be a critic.
Well, I started off as a playwright, so
yeah,
I spent
20
years.
You earned your chops.
A playwright.
Okay, fine.
And an actor before I decided to start criticizing everything. But I'm still doing. I'm a member of the Actors Studio. Yes, I am as a playwright director. So I'm still doing that too, or trying to. But this is what I've become known for: is chatting, you know, with preeminent people like yourself. And so let's see. You come back. You got your first film was Tom Jones. Oh my God!
First film was Tom Jones, and
you followed that up with
a whole bunch of stuff. But the one that was the most fun was my cousin's husband had said I should read this book by Ian Fleming about this guy James Bond, and I read the book and I liked it and I said, hey, make a hell of a movie. So I called our office. See if the rights were available, and the answer was Mr. Fleming is not prepared to sell the rights. So I totally forgot about it. And a couple of years go by.
Ian Fleming,
who wrote them. And a couple of years go by, and a London office calls and says, Cubby Broccoli and Harry Saltzman are coming to New York. They'd like to meet with you and Mr. Krim, my boss. And what about? Well, they didn't tell me. They just want to have the meeting. So Cubby was someone who'd produced many pictures for Columbia and was a quality kind of action-adventure producer. Harry, I only knew because of his association with a company called Woodfall Films. Never met him. The company had made two or three small, very good quality movies, but I didn't know the man. But anyway, they come in and they asked if they could meet with Arthur Krim and Bob Benjamin and myself. And we sit down and... Cubby says, well, we have the rights to James Bond. And we didn't let him out of the room. We met 2 hours. We worked out the deal. And I kept saying to myself, why are they here? How come Cubby hasn't made this deal with Columbia? He's done all his movies with Columbia. And we finish everything. And Cubby then says, I just have to make one phone call.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. And I said to myself, oh, no. I know he's got to be calling Columbia. He's got to be. Saying he's got a deal at UA, you know, that they want to. He's out of the room, 5 minutes. It was a long 5 minutes in my head. Comes back in the room and he says, we have a deal. And I subsequently found out that's exactly what he did. He called Columbia. He told me this. He tried to get the head of production that he normally dealt with, who would turn the project down, and he couldn't get him. But he got the head of the American distribution office, the salesman, but the head of sales, and got him on the phone and said, listen, I'm at UA. I spoke to Mike Frankovich about this before I left. He turned me down, but UA is prepared to do it, and I'm coming back to you for one last shot. And of course, the man he spoke to knew nothing about the content or anything. And he said, but Mike turned it down. He said, yeah, Mike turned it down. He said, well, if he turned it down, that's it. I can't say yes. And he came back in the room and said, we have a deal. And to this day, it's impossible for me to understand how they could not have wanted to make
James Bond.
No, I mean, it was books. It wasn't a movie yet. But they did. They said no, and we said yes. The rest is history.
Yes, and then you made a little film called A Hard Day's Night, another one of my favorite films of all time.
Well, that was more interesting.
The Beatles.
Yeah, but that was more interesting. I mean,
and we're going to pause right now and then come right back.